Hi, I'm Amy Goodman. In this critical election year, you count on Democracy Now! To stay focused on the stories that matter most. And we count on you to support our independent journalism. If everyone who tunes into Democracy Now! Signed up for a monthly donation of, say, just $6, we could cover our operating costs for the entire year. Really, that's all it would take. Please do your part today by visiting us at democracynow.org. Stay safe. Wear a mask, save lives. And thank you so much. From New York, this is Democracy Now!
I was wondering what time it was, and then I looked outside and it looked like doomsday. I mean, you could tell something is horribly going wrong.
The skies of the Bay Area and Northern California turned a dark orange Wednesday as 90 major fires burned in the west from San Diego to the Canadian border. At least 7 people have already died.
I quite literally have no patience for climate change deniers. It simply follows completely inconsistent that point of view with the reality on the ground, the facts as we are experiencing. You may not believe it intellectually, but your own eyes, your own experiences tell a different story.
We'll go to California for the latest. Then, as President Trump says a coronavirus vaccine could be approved before the election, we'll look at how the testing process could be slowed by a failure to recruit many African-American and Latinx people for the vaccine trials. We'll speak to medical ethicist Harriet Washington, author of Medical Apartheid, The Dark History of Medical Experimentation on Black Americans from Colonial Times to the Present.
So certainly the signals to many people of color that they are not being treated equitably, that their lives are not being considered as valuable as other people, and some fear that they're being used as sacrificial lambs in the process.
And we'll look at key issues involved in carrying out clinical trials on vulnerable populations around the world. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Residents of the San Francisco Bay Area and Northern California woke up Wednesday to dark orange skies as a blanket of smoke from the state's massive climate change-fueled wildfires smothered the region. The thick smoke blotted out so much sunlight, temperatures dropped well below forecasters' predictions, with meteorologists comparing the effect to a nuclear winter. Many residents described the scene as apocalyptic. The fires have also devastated Oregon, where dozens of blazes have destroyed hundreds of homes and even entire towns. Oregon Governor Kate Brown said it could be the greatest disaster in Oregon's history.
I want to be up front in saying that we expect to see a great deal of loss, both in structures and in human lives. This could be the greatest loss of human lives and property due to wildfire in our state's history.
The fires left at least 7 people dead across Washington, Oregon, and California. More fires are raging in Montana, Colorado, and Utah. After headlines, we'll go to California for the latest. Meanwhile, new satellite data show fires in Brazil's Amazon region leaped to a 10-year high in August, with many of the blazes consuming virgin forest rather than already deforested areas. This comes as a new report finds populations of mammals, birds, amphibians, reptiles, and fish have plummeted worldwide by a staggering 68% since 1970. In its biennial Living Planet report, the World Wildlife Fund warns, quote, biodiversity is fundamental to human life on Earth, and the evidence is unequivocal. It's being destroyed by us at a rate unprecedented in history. President Donald Trump acknowledged Wednesday he publicly downplayed the threat of COVID-19 for weeks as the coronavirus spread across the globe, even after he received briefings early this year about the severity of the looming pandemic. Trump was responding to a reporter who asked if he misled the public in order to reduce panic.
Well, I think if you said in order to reduce panic, perhaps that's so. The fact is, I'm a cheerleader for this country. I love our country. And I don't want people to be frightened. I don't want to create panic.
Trump's admission came hours after Washington Post journalist Bob Woodward published bombshell excerpts from his forthcoming book about Trump titled Rage, along with tape conversations he has repeatedly had with the president. In a February 7th phone call, Trump told Woodward about what he learned about the novel coronavirus from Chinese President Xi Jinping.
It goes through air, Bob. That's always tougher than the touch. You know, the touch, you don't have to touch things, right? But the air, you just breathe the air. That's how it's passed. And so that's a very tricky one. That's a very delicate one. It's also more deadly than your strenuous flus. This is more deadly. This is 5% versus 1% and less than 1%.
President Trump.
So this is deadly stuff.
President Trump made those comments on February 7th. The White House would not declare a national emergency until March 13th. During the intervening weeks, Trump repeatedly and forcefully denied that coronavirus posed a significant threat to the American people. For instance, on March 4th, Trump dismissed a World Health Organization finding that the global death rate from COVID-19 was 3.4%. Trump was speaking on Fox News.
Well, I think the 3.4% is really a false number. Now, this is just my hunch, but based on a lot of conversations with a lot of people that do this, because a lot of people will have this, and it's very mild.
2 weeks after those comments on March 19th, Trump privately admitted in another call with Bob Woodward, he'd publicly downplayed the severity of the pandemic.
I wanted to always play it down. I still like playing it down.
Yes, sir.
Because I don't want to create a panic.
Columbia University disease modelers report if states had begun social distancing measures just 1 week earlier in March, 36,000 fewer people would have died. On Wednesday, Democratic presidential candidate Joe Biden seized on reports that Trump had deliberately misled the public about the coronavirus. Biden was speaking at an outdoor campaign event in Michigan.
He had the information. He knew how dangerous it was. And while this deadly disease ripped through our nation, he failed to do his job on purpose. It was a life and death betrayal of the American people.
Meanwhile, Bob Woodward is under fire for holding back his reporting on Trump's deception for months while the pandemic raged across the United States. Esquire magazine politics blogger Charles Pierce tweeted, quote, Bob Woodward knew the truth behind the administration's deadly bungling and worse, and he saved it for his book, which will be released to wild acclaim and huge profits after nearly 200,000 Americans have died, unquote. In further revelations from his book, Bob Woodward writes, Trump boasted about a highly classified new type of nuclear weapon, and he quotes top infectious disease scientist Dr. Anthony Fauci saying of President Trump, quote, his attention span is like a minus number. His sole person is to get reelected, unquote. This comes as Politico has revealed a Trump appointee within the Department of Health and Human Services has attempted to prevent Dr. Fauci from discussing the risks coronavirus poses to children during recent media interviews. In newly disclosed emails, the official falsely claims there's zero evidence children spread the virus to others. On Wednesday, National Institutes of Health Director Dr. Francis Collins testified on Capitol Hill and responded to concerns the Trump administration would rush approval of vaccine prior to the election before it's fully tested.
And certainly to try to predict whether it happens on a particular week before or after a particular date in early November is well beyond anything that any scientist right now could tell you and be confident that they know what they're saying. So, yes, science and science alone will be the way in which this decision is made. Otherwise, I'll have no part of it.
In education news, the entire student bodies of Winona State University in Minnesota and Bradley University in Illinois have been ordered to quarantine for 2 weeks after coronavirus spread on their campuses. While the University of Wisconsin-Madison has canceled in-person classes after more than 1,000 people tested positive for COVID-19 just 5 days into the fall semester. Los Angeles County has canceled Halloween, barring residents from trick-or-treating or gathering at parties or haunted houses. cases. Meanwhile, Yahoo News reports the Trump administration's planning to halt enhanced coronavirus screenings for international travelers arriving at U.S. airports. The global coronavirus death toll has passed 900,000. On Wednesday, India reported nearly 96,000 new cases, a new daily record. Meanwhile, in Indonesia, Jakarta has reinstated a partial lockdown as a new surge in cases is threatening to overwhelm Jakarta's hospitals. A Department of Homeland Security whistleblower has accused the agency's leadership of instructing analysts to downplay the violent threat posed by white supremacists and of Russia's efforts to interfere in the 2020 election. The explosive allegation comes in a whistleblower complaint filed by Brian Murphy, the former head of the Homeland Security Department's intelligence branch. Murphy says acting DHS Secretary Chad Wolf personally instructed him to stop providing intelligence assessments on the threat of Russian interference and instead to focus on actions by China and Iran. Murphy claims the request originated from Trump's national security advisor, Robert O'Brien. In July, Murphy said one of his intelligence reports on Russia was held because it, quote, made the president look bad. Murphy also said he'd been ordered to alter the text of assessments to make the threat of white supremacy, quote, appear less severe. Earlier this year, DHS drafted a document stating, quote, white supremacist extremists will remain the most persistent and lethal threat in the homeland through 2021. But in newer versions of the document, the reference to white supremacists was removed. Murphy also claims leaders at DHS pressured analysts to change assessments to match up to comments made by President Trump attacking anti-fascist groups. A software engineer at Facebook has resigned to protest the company's activities, saying Facebook is, quote, on the wrong side of history. In an open letter to coworkers, Ashok Chowdhury wrote, quote, I'm quitting because I can no longer stomach contributing to an organization that's profiting off hate in the U.S. and globally. Chowdhury cited Facebook's role in fueling genocide in Burma and for allowing a far-right militia to use the platform to recruit armed vigilantes recently to come to Kenosha, Wisconsin, to confront Black Lives Matter protesters. One of the militia supporters then shot dead two anti-racist protesters. Meanwhile, Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg has rejected claims the platform has become a platform for the far right. He appeared on Axios on HBO.
I don't think that the service is a right-wing echo chamber, to use your words. I think that, you know, everyone can use their voice and can find media that they trust that reflects the opinions and the life experiences that they're having.
Vice President Mike Pence is scheduled to head to Montana next week for a fundraiser hosted by two supporters of the far-right QAnon conspiracy theory. The host, Michael Borland, and his wife have repeatedly promoted QAnon on social media. Borland has also described Black Lives Matter protesters as terrorists and once threatened to shoot protesters. In Lebanon, a massive fire has broken out at the port of Beirut just 1 month after a catastrophic explosion at the port killed over 200 people and injured over 7,000 and left more than 250,000 residents homeless. Officials say Thursday's fire began at a warehouse storing oil and tires in the port's duty-free zone. In Mexico, journalist Julio Valdivia was found murdered and beheaded Wednesday in a remote part of the Gulf Coast state of Veracruz. The 44-year-old specialized in covering Mexico's notorious criminal gangs and narco-traffickers, the fifth journalist, at least, assassinated in Mexico this year, according to Reporters Without Borders. Meanwhile, thousands of farmers stormed a dam in Mexico's northern border state of Chihuahua Tuesday, using firebombs, sticks and rocks to drive back National Guard soldiers who opened fire with tear gas and live ammunition, killing two protesters. The farmers are demanding Mexico stop diverting water to the United States from La Boquilla Dam, which they say has left them unable to irrigate their crops amidst a searing drought. This is Abel Alvarado, one of the protesters.
It is a reaction from citizens who are defending their homeland. Water is everyone's heritage. Water doesn't belong to anyone. Water is for everyone in Chihuahua, for all Mexicans.
Under terms of a 1944 treaty, Mexico owes the United States nearly 500,000,000 cubic meters of water to be paid by October 24th. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with my co-host, Nermeen Sheikh. Hi, Nermeen.
Good morning, Amy, and welcome to our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world.
Well, we begin today's show in California, where people in the Bay Area and across Northern California woke up Wednesday to dark orange skies as a blanket of smoke from the state's massive climate change-fueled wildfires smothered the region. The thick smoke blotted out so much sunlight, temperatures dropped well below forecasters' predictions, with meteorologists comparing the effect to a nuclear winter. The unprecedented conditions came as the West Coast faces a fire season that has killed at least 7 people, forced major evacuations, and already burned 2.5 million acres in California alone. That's 20 times the land burned last year, and there are months left in California's ever-growing fire season. Winds from some of California's more than 20 massive fires and from blazes as far away as Oregon and Washington blew into the Bay Area to create the conditions which some described as apocalyptic. This is Oakland resident Carl Juan Anderson.
I was wondering what time it was, and then I looked outside, and it looked like doomsday. I mean, you could tell something is horribly going wrong, and as far as going to work and breathing in all this pollution is definitely not healthy for us as in the Bay Area.
The fires have also devastated Oregon, where dozens of wildfires have destroyed hundreds of homes and even entire towns. Oregon Governor Kate Brown said it could be the greatest loss of lives and property from fire in the state's history. This is a video posted on Twitter by reporter Christine Padawanich with Oregon's KGW News. It shows downtown Staten, about an hour south of Portland, just after noon Tuesday. The sky is blood red.
This right here is downtown Staten. You can see the red hue, the red-orange glow in the sky. There's ash that is falling visibly in front of, when we were driving here, in front of the headlights of the car. But downtown, basically empty here, besides a few people, a few cars here, people walking around in cars. But the smell of smoke is heavy.
Meanwhile, wildfires in the neighboring state of Washington have burned nearly 600,000 acres since Labor Day. The fires devastating the West come as a record-shattering heat wave, mass blackouts, and the coronavirus pandemic roil the West. The scientists are unflinching in their analysis. The climate crisis is here, and it's impacting farm workers still forced to work the fields, incarcerated firefighters, and other vulnerable communities first and hardest. This is California Governor Gavin Newsom speaking Tuesday.
But I quite literally have no patience for climate change deniers. It simply follows completely inconsistent that point of view with the reality on the ground, the facts as we are experiencing. You may not believe it intellectually, but your own eyes, your own experiences tell a different story.
Well, for more, we're joined by Leah Stokes, assistant professor of political science at the University of California, Santa Barbara, researcher on climate and energy policy. She's the author of Short-Circuiting Policy, Interest Groups, and the Battle Over Clean Energy and Climate Policy in the American States. Can you describe what we are seeing from California to Oregon to Washington? The media talks about it as bizarre and crazy. Still, there is not a lot of use of the word climate change.
That's right, Amy. It's quite sad that your program and one newscaster at CBS News named Jeff Berardelli are pretty much the only TV news stations that are willing to use the word climate change. Last month, during August, when the fires, of course, had already started, there were over 100 TV news segments on this on ABC, NBC, and CBS. This is according to Media Matters. And of those more than 100 segments, I'm talking about 5 full segments, that's it, that even mentioned the word climate change. And 3 of those 5 were done by one person, Jeff Berardelli, who's a wonderful meteorologist who actually cares about talking about climate change. But the fact is that TV news is completely abdicating its responsibility when it comes to telling the truth of what the West is dealing with right now, which is, of course, not just these fires, but massive unprecedented heat waves. The fires that got really bad over the weekend were fueled in large part by unprecedented heat in counties like Los Angeles County, which set heat wave records of 121 degrees Fahrenheit, Ventura County, Santa Barbara County, inland. I mean, the temperatures were just unseen before in modern human history. So this is climate change. It's not rocket science. And when will the media start calling it that?
And Professor Stokes, could you also talk about what's been pointed out? Because some think that the reason that people conclude that this is an effect of climate change is that now records are kept, whereas previously they weren't. But in fact, in California, since 1932, fire records have been kept, and the worst fires have occurred, the 10 worst fires have occurred between the year 2000 and the present.
Yes, and unfortunately, that statistic, which is a really great one, is probably going out of date as we speak. You know, as you mentioned at the top of the hour, we're talking about 2.5 million acres that have already burned. And that is, as Amy mentioned, 20 times what had burned at this time last year. And we know because of research that the fire season across the western United States has lengthened by 2.5 months. So we're not really in fire seasons anymore. We're in fire season year round. And, you know, this isn't a question of modern record keeping. It's a question of burning fossil fuels, which is what we've been doing, which has been heating up the planet, and as scientists tell us, have increased fire risk by 500%. That's the kind of increase that we're seeing as a result of climate change.
You know, I was talking with family last night in New York, which was afternoon there, and they took me outside on Skype, and it was dark. But Professor Stokes, can you explain the colors that are being experienced from pumpkin orange to purple to complete darkness? What exactly is causing all of this? And how do you think the governor is dealing with it? And then talk about President Trump.
Sure. So what happens with these giant wildfires is really unprecedented weather that we've never seen before. There's a wonderful climate scientist, very active on Twitter, named Daniel Swain. And what he's been talking about is how overwhelmed he is by even trying to track the amount of fires that are going on right now. And these fires are creating their own weather. They're creating clouds and kind of tornado-like conditions. And what that is doing is like a volcano eruption. It's pushing particulate matter way up into the stratosphere, way higher than even airplanes fly. And that is like a volcanic eruption. And so what we're dealing with here is particulate matter blocking out the sun. And so, for example, people posted their solar panels and showed that they were getting zero solar radiation, no energy being produced because the sun was not making its way to the ground. This is what's happened in the past when we've had huge volcanic eruptions. It's really a disturbing effect, and I can understand why people are so freaked out. In terms of the governor of California, it's great to see him stepping up and using the words climate change very actively. Others have pointed out, however, that he has approved fracking permits in the recent months during the pandemic, and there's questions as to why California is not turning away more aggressively from oil and gas extraction. And then when it comes to our climate denier in chief, Donald Trump, you know, he doesn't even believe in climate change. He doesn't listen to scientists, whether that's the coronavirus pandemic and lying about it and playing down the death toll, or it's climate change. And so really, we have zero leadership for this emergency from Washington, D.C. And it's well past time that we have a president who can use the words climate change and who can trust and believe in science.
Professor Stokes, you mentioned earlier a fossil fuel, of course, which is one of the leading causes of accelerated climate change. And in your article in The Atlantic, How Can We Plan for the Future in California, you write, quote, in an ironic twist, burning fossil fuels will become less reliable in our hotter world. Can you explain?
Sure. So these heat waves that we've been dealing with really all summer, they're unprecedented. And that's because science has told us that we have, again, 500% more risk for heat waves across the western United States, given the amount of climate change that we've already caused. We've warmed the planet by 1 degree Celsius. In certain parts of California, such as where I live, Santa Barbara, the warming is actually higher. It's 2 degrees Celsius in Santa Barbara and in Ventura County. So certain parts of our planet are really more vulnerable to climate change, and they warm up faster. And that is certainly parts of California. So what's been happening is that the West, whether it's Arizona, Nevada, California, they've been baked in a big regional heat wave over the last few weeks. And that creates a big stress on our electricity system, because people in Phoenix need to turn on their air conditioning, people in Los Angeles need to turn that on, all across the region. And so that means that we don't have as much electricity resources than we would have otherwise. And so there have been regional shortages, particularly in California, for electricity. And a few weeks ago, the grid actually went into rolling blackouts. And even this past week, there have been shortages and some shutoffs in some areas. Now, what happened a couple weeks ago is still being understood. But one of the factors is that several gas plants, these are fossil gas plants that operate in California, they went offline unexpectedly. And what people pointed out is that when the temperature gets really high, just like if you've ever been in an airport when the temperature is really high and airplanes can't take off, when the temperature gets very high, fossil plants cannot produce the same amount of electricity. They cannot operate. And so as we deal with more and more heat waves, our electricity system is going to become a lot less reliable.
And President Trump's connection to the fossil fuel companies, one, and two, the people who are fighting these fires. We have been dealing with this extensively on Democracy Now! But, for example, the incarcerated firefighters who themselves are dealing with COVID, and then the farm workers who are out in the fields being told they still have to be there.
Yes. There's so many tragic parts of this story and so many of the other ones that you touched on at the top of the hour. These are very dark days that we are living in. Unfortunately, what many people don't know is that the CARES Act, which was the coronavirus stimulus bill that Mitch McConnell helped steward through Congress a few months ago, that was in large part a fossil fuel bailout. We do not even know how much of our money as people living in the United States has gone towards fossil fuel companies because the federal government refuses to tell us. But we do know, thanks to the really dogged reporting of a few women, including Antonia Hujas, writing for Sierra Magazine, and Alexis Goldstein, writing for Truthout, that a lot of money, we're talking billions of dollars, is going to fossil fuel companies. Alexis just reported, for example, that the Federal Reserve literally bought corporate bonds, corporate debt of a number of fossil fuel companies. So you and I now own corporate debt for ExxonMobil, Chevron, BP, Marathon Petroleum, and the electric utility company, Southern Company. These are terrible corporations that have been denying climate change for decades, and they're not, you know, responsible corporate actors. And yet, what has the Trump administration done? It has given them a lifeline and a handout at a time when they were not doing well financially, not because of COVID, but because of their own bad decisions. So really, what we are living through right now is a massive fossil fuel bailout. What the federal government is doing is not helping everyday Americans stay employed, pay their rent, pay their electricity bills. What they are doing is helping fossil fuel companies, and that's really wrong. Amy, you also mentioned, of course, the prison labor problem when it comes to firefighting in California. And that issue has been really compounded by the COVID crisis. In Santa Barbara County, where I live, there is one prison where pretty much 100% of the people, about 1,000 people who are in that prison, have had COVID. In the early parts of the pandemic, this was one of the worst outbreaks in the entire country. And prisons across this country and across California have really been on the front lines of COVID. And so one thing that Governor Newsom has done, in part to help people out in prisons, is early releases. Unfortunately, that means that the firefighters who we rely on through prison labor, which is a problematic situation, we don't have as many of them as a result. And so we don't have the same amount of firefighters. And we also have a terrible policy in California that after people have been released from prison, they're not allowed to work as firefighters for an actual living wage. And so the system that we have set up for fighting our fires is really unethical, not just exploiting people when they're in prison, but after we've trained them and given them skills, not letting them use those skills for pay. And finally, the farm workers. You're right. Many undocumented Hispanic people living in this country are on the front lines of COVID, on the front lines of the climate crisis, and they're still out there working in the fields during a pandemic and during this absolutely horrendous air quality, which, of course, when you breathe in that bad air, it also makes it more likely that you'll die of COVID.
We have 30 seconds. The future, Leah Stokes. What needs to happen now?
We need to elect a new president. You know, Joe Biden, for all his flaws, has come out with an absolutely unprecedented climate change plan, and he's targeting 100% clean electricity by 2035. So if we could elect him to be the president and we could take back the Senate for the Democrats, we would actually have a chance to tackle the climate crisis.
Leah Stokes, I want to thank you for being with us, assistant professor of political science at University of California, Santa Barbara, researcher on climate and energy policy. We'll link to your piece in The Atlantic headlined, How Can We Plan for the Future in California?, author of Short-Circuiting Policy, Interest Groups in the Battle Over Clean Energy and Climate Policy in the American States. When we come back, a new ad campaign targets African-American and Latinx Americans to join in the vaccine trials. What are many's hesitation? We look back at medical experimentation in the United States. Stay with us. Summer Madness by Kool and the Gang, the band's co-founder, singer, and composer, Ronald Kalis Bell, has passed away at the age of 68. This is Democracy Now!, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh. President Donald Trump acknowledged Wednesday he publicly downplayed the threat of the coronavirus, even as he received briefings in early February about the severity of the looming pandemic. Trump was responding to a reporter who asked if he misled the public in order to reduce panic.
Well, I think if you said in order to reduce panic, perhaps that's so. The fact is, I'm a cheerleader for this country. I love our country. And I don't want people to be frightened. I don't want to create panic.
Mission came hours after Washington Post journalist Bob Woodward published bombshell experts from his forthcoming book about Trump called Rage, along with taped conversations with the president. In a February 7th phone call, Trump told Woodward about what he learned about the coronavirus from Chinese President Xi Jinping.
It goes through air, Bob. That's always tougher than the touch. You know, the touch, you don't have to touch things, right? But the air, you just breathe the air, and that's how it's passed. And so that's a very tricky one. That's a very delicate one. It's also more deadly than your, you know, your even your strenuous flus. This is more deadly. This is 5% versus 1% and less than 1%, you know, so this is deadly stuff.
Now, again, that was President Trump on February 7th, but the White House would not declare a national emergency on COVID-19 until March 13th. The revelations come as the U.S. death toll from COVID-19 reached 190,000 on Wednesday. This comes as Trump's push to release a vaccine before the November election called Operation Warp Speed could be slowed by a lack of participation in vaccine trials by African-American, Indigenous and Latinx people, many of whom mistrust the healthcare system, even as the coronavirus disproportionately impacts these same communities. A National Institutes Health report attributed part of this mistrust to, quote, the historical legacy of mistreatment at the hands of the medical profession. The most notorious abuse of African Americans at the hands of the medical establishment was the Tuskegee syphilis experiment. In 1932, the U.S. Public Health Service recruited 400 African American men with syphilis studying the disease's progression when purposefully left untreated. The subjects were given useless placebos and tracked over decades as their symptoms worsened, even though penicillin was identified as a reliable treatment in 1945. Syphilis can disfigure, cause dementia, blindness, extreme chronic pain, and death. Repeated concerns with the unethical study were ignored until a whistleblower's account of the experiment to the press in 1972 shut it down. Well, on Tuesday, the NIH attempted to overcome the legacy helped launch a series of TV commercials on the BET network, the Oprah Winfrey Network, Telemundo and Univision, like this ad, which features a series of black people.
We know that someone somewhere is full of hope and strength and wants to take action and will take a step forward to hug her grandkids. Walking the walk and rolling up their sleeves to go back to normal sooner. Volunteer to find the COVID-19 vaccine.
We're joined now by Harriet Washington, medical ethicist, author of Medical Apartheid, The Dark History of Medical Experimentation on Black Americans from Colonial Times to the Present. Her latest book, A Terrible Thing to Waste, Environmental Racism and Its Assault on the American Mind. Welcome back to Democracy Now!, Harriet Washington. We're going to talk global issues in a moment. But for people who are not familiar, for example, with the Tuskegee experiment, and what that experiment means, which you lay out so well in your book, Medical Apartheid, how this could possibly happen. I wanted to go to a 1993 documentary about the Tuskegee experiments called Deadly Deception, which addresses how black men were lured into the Tuskegee experiment with assurances they were actually receiving medical care. Many told spinal taps were a form of treatment. This clip includes interviews with Tuskegee subject Herman Shaw and medical historian Vanessa Gamble.
This letter sent to each man before his spinal tap claimed it was a very special free treatment.
Some time ago, you were given a thorough examination. And since that time, we hope you have gotten a great deal of treatment for bad blood. You will now be given your last chance to get a second examination. This examination is a very special one, and after it is finished, you will be given a special treatment
if it is believed you are in a condition to stand it. Remember, this is your last chance for a special free treatment.
The men were told that the spinal taps were a treatment. That shows you some of the deception and deceit involved in the study. And these are physicians saying this so that it has a certain power and authority of physicians saying this.
On each subject, they performed physicals and blood tests. And to maintain the appearance of treatment, the doctors gave the men placebos, vitamins, aspirins, and tonics, all useless against syphilis.
We got three different types of medicine. We got a little round pill, and sometimes they give us a capsule. And then they would use a little vial of liquid medicine. Everybody got the same thing.
These were men who weren't going to question the system, who weren't going to question the government doctors, who weren't going to be out there picketing and writing and protesting about it. These were men in Macon County, Alabama. Who was going to speak for them?
That clip from a 1993 documentary about the Tuskegee experiment called Deadly Deception. This experiment, Harriet Washington, went on for 40 years?
Yes, it did. It's the longest instance of unethical medical experimentation in Western history. However, it's one study. My book, Medical Apartheid, documents centuries of studies, many, if not most of which, were far worse than Tuskegee.
Can you go through just some of them with us, a kind of short journey with us to the, I mean, it's hard to talk about this, to the experimentation on African-Americans in this country?
Of course. You know, it's 500 pages and for a century, so I can't possibly summarize it. But they range from things like pouring boiling water on the backs of slaves to treat them for typhoid, to removing slaves' arms and legs simply to show medical students how the procedures of amputation were done, to locking women in literally a cage, a small laboratory on the property of Dr. James Marion Sims, and then subjecting them to reproductive surgeries that were experimental over the course of 5 years at least. And then also removing the jawbone of a slave despite his protests, testing vaccine on slaves, testing other novel procedures, and appropriating the bodies of slaves in order to test modalities, in order to use them for various experiments, and also to use their bodies after death for anatomical dissection as medical training material, post-mortem racism. These things were so prevalent that most northern medical schools had contracts with southern medical schools to get the bodies of dead black people because they didn't want to use dead whites in this matter. It was considered disrespectful. The history is extremely extensive. It goes on for a very, very long time. And frankly, it has not ended. When it comes to vaccine, I actually find more troubling, far more troubling than Tuskegee, which is not a good parallel for this problem, more recent problems with vaccines. Vaccine experiments that have been very have been unethical and exploitative, and other procedures, especially in the developing world, that have been exploitative, that have caught the attention of African Americans and others. So even the recent history of vaccine abuse has been very troubling and caused a lot of reticence.
Harriet Washington, could you talk about how widespread the knowledge is of the older medical experiments that you were speaking of and what role you think that history, as opposed to the treatment of Latinx and African Americans in the medical world today, to what extent is knowledge of that medical history kind of a disincentive for people to enroll in the vaccine trials now? As opposed to the continuing discrimination against Latinx and Black communities now?
I would not put those things in opposition to each other. They both contribute. But it's important to realize that the written history of medicine, the canon, has been carefully curated to elide the experience of African Americans. You simply would not find this history detailed in other history of medicine books. Until Medical Apartheid was published, it was ignored. It was certainly documented in the past in old journals and medical doctors' own, own research reports, but no one had collected it. So you find that in academia, there was very little knowledge of that. However, amid African-American communities, there was a great extensive knowledge of it because there had been a rich oral tradition passed on. Many people had those in their families who had been subjected to experimental abuse, and this knowledge was prevalent and passed on. So we had the unusual situation where African-Americans were quite conversant with the history. They may not have known, they probably could not have known, the details that I got from reading medical journals because they were not allowed access to the medical journals, but they knew these things were occurring. But in terms of history of medicine canon, they were routinely ignored. And there was a lot of reluctance until Medical Apartheid was published, and scholars could see how carefully I had documented the things I had described. Only then was there an admission that these things had actually happened within academia.
Dr. Fauci, the infectious disease specialist, says that if you look at the trials that are taking place in the United States today, Moderna has 16% Latinx participation. Pfizer has 11% Latinx participation. Moderna has only 10% Black participation and Pfizer only 8%. Fauci recommends 37% Latinx participation and 27% Black participation. When we come back, we're going to go global with you, Harriet Washington. Again, Harriet Washington is a medical ethicist and author of Medical Apartheid, The Dark History of Medical Experimentation on Black Americans from Colonial Times to the Present. She mentioned a Pfizer test in Nigeria, and we'll talk about that, look at South Africa, India, and beyond. Stay with us. Static by Godspeed, you Black Emperor. This is Democracy Now!, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh as we continue to look at medical experimentation, also how COVID-19 vaccine trials are unfolding globally. On Wednesday, India reported nearly 96,000 new COVID cases, a new daily record just 2 days after it surpassed Brazil as the country's second hardest hit by the virus after the United States. This comes as the Indian company enlisted to manufacture a billion doses of AstraZeneca's experimental COVID-19 vaccine is pushing ahead with its own clinical trial, even as safety concerns led the British drug maker to halt its tests this week. For more, we are also joined by Kaushik Sundararajan, professor of anthropology at the University of Chicago, author of the book Pharmacracy, Value, Politics, and Knowledge in Global Biomedicine. And we're still joined by Harriet Washington, the medical ethicist, author of Medical Apartheid, The Dark History of Medical Experimentation on Black Americans from Colonial Times to the Present. Before we are also talking to Professor Rajan, Harriet Washington, you mentioned Pfizer in Nigeria. It's a notorious 1996 drug experiment that Pfizer conducted on sick children in Nigeria when researchers selected 200 children at an epidemic hospital for an experimental trial. About 100 of the kids were given an untested oral version of the antibiotic Trovan. Researchers did not obtain signed consent forms. Medical personnel said Pfizer did not tell their parents their children were getting the experimental drug. 11 children died. Others suffered disabling injuries, including deafness, muteness, paralysis, brain damage, loss of sight, slurred speech. After an 11-year legal battle, Pfizer paid compensation to four families. About 10 years ago, we spoke to Musikilu Mojeed, a Nigerian journalist who worked on this story for the next newspaper in Lagos. He described what Pfizer did in Nigeria.
Pfizer just went in, you know, briefly, and there was so much confusion in Nigeria. Nigeria needed help. There was this epidemic. The country just needed help from wherever, you know. And Pfizer came on humanitarian ground. Nigeria accepted. And at the time, we had military dictatorship. Things were so bad. There was no order in the country. There was no proper procedures were never followed in most of the things that happened at the time. So really, at the time, Nigerians were grateful to Pfizer. And we never knew until it broke out in the press several years later, and Nigerians were really, really outraged.
That's Musikilu Mojeed, a Nigerian journalist who worked on this issue. Medical apartheid, global, I guess you could say. Tell us further about why you think this is such a critical experiment for us to understand today.
Well, it's actually one of many. Research design in the developing world is supposed to be governed by the same laws as the U.S. Researchers are supposed to adhere to U.S. law. The problem is there's little or no oversight. We only take researchers' word that they are conforming and making sure there's informed consent. And abuses as such as happened in Kano, Nigeria, show us that sometimes people lie. A doctor admitted having deceitfully claimed that there had been the certification that was required. They forged the form after the research was already conducted. And so abuses abound because there's very little oversight and because there's a different attitude toward people in the developing world. I think the best illustration of that in regard to coronavirus 19 is what happened in April when two French doctors suggested quite openly that trials were ethically troubled because they were placebo trials falling out of favor in the West, be brought to Africa instead, where they were abundant of subjects who had no medical care and would grasp at whatever straw was offered them, and it could be conducted on people like prostitutes. So this kind of there's a lot of outrage over their statements, but what they were saying is something I have seen stated in medical journals repeatedly. They're not the only one saying this, and more to the point, they're not the only one doing it. The research conducted in the developing world often dispense with informed consent. A variety of excuses are offered for it, and sometimes researchers are not honest about what they have done.
Professor Kaushik Sundarajan, if you could comment on what Harriet has just said and talk about some of your concerns with clinical trials being held in among vulnerable populations, not just here in the U.S., but around the world, including India, where you've studied them.
Sure, Nadmeen, and thanks for having me on. It's a pleasure to be on the show. So, it's ironic. 9 years ago, almost exactly to this day, you may recall that Michelle Bachmann was on a tirade against the HPV vaccine in the Republican primary. And Bachmann's anti-vaccine position was roundly and correctly condemned by scientists and the public health community. And it highlighted, but at the very same time, a major scandal was erupting around some experimental demonstration studies of the HPV vaccine in India. So this highlighted the fact that there are good reasons to be concerned about clinical trials and vaccines, but they're not Michelle Bachmann's reasons. So I want to start by saying here that the critical issue is not whether vaccines are good or bad, but as you've already talked about, some of the ethical issues surrounding their production, their distribution and rollout. But even more, I would suggest what is at stake is a democratic public health. Because if we think about something like the HPV vaccine studies in India, the key question was about accountability. Who is held accountable by whom and how? These studies were demonstration studies on the vaccine being conducted prior to the rollout of the vaccine as part of India's national immunization program. And in the process, 7 girls who belonged to indigenous populations who were on the study died. Now, it was never established that the girls died because of the vaccine or because of the studies, and it's quite possible that there was no correlation. However, commissions of inquiry set up after the study showed substantial procedural violations had occurred, including failure to obtain adequate consent for the studies from the parents of the girls. There were multiple institutional entities involved in the studies, both Indian state institutions, but also U.S. not-for-profits, including the Gates Foundation-funded Program for Appropriate Technology in Health, or PATH. And for me, the critical issue here is, of course, that there were ethical lapses. That is serious. But it was also that no one was held accountable in spite of sustained civil society advocacy and media attention. And some of this is because these clinical studies are so extensively brokered with so many different kinds of public and private entities insourcing and outsourcing both the science and the ethics that responsibility becomes almost a kind of shell game. So it's very hard, unless there's gross intentional fraud, to say this is this entity's fault. But the other part of it is that when the studies erupted in scandal, PATH didn't show up, right? They issued vehement defenses of their action in Western public health journals and to colleagues here, but civil society and community health advocates in India never got the answers that they were demanding. And that, more than anything else, is the lingering ground for anger, which is that you can't have a genuinely public health without genuine public accountability.
And Professor Sundarajan, also, if you could talk about the question of access. The people who participate in clinical trials for these vaccines are not necessarily those who first get the vaccine once one is approved.
Yes, I think that's potentially true. And I think that if we're thinking about COVID, for instance, questions of manufacturing scale-up, distributive justice, rollout, supply chain, all of these are going to be nightmarishly complicated logistical questions. But I think you're raising a more fundamental point, which is that a pandemic or a disease or a response to a disease, a vaccine, is never just a biological problem. It's always inherently a social problem. And the vaccine solves the biological part of that problem. But unless it's allied to democratically accountable, socially inclusive mechanisms of distribution and access, there are always going to be problems. And we can speculate upon what that might mean in relation to COVID. But what I want to suggest is that there's, of course, a critical issue of an essential artifact being produced that needs to be made equitably accessible. But I think that the question here might be even broader than that, right? So we have a situation at this moment where, early optimistic estimations for how long a COVID vaccine would take suggested 18 months to 2 years, and even that would have been remarkable. But there's been such an unprecedented amount of research being done globally on COVID towards both therapeutic and vaccine development that I have biologist friends who are telling me that it's not unreasonable to expect a successful vaccine by the end of the year. And then there is a question of whether and how that would be made equitably accessible. But I think there's also a question beyond that of social infrastructures, right? Because what we're dealing with is, you'd mentioned vulnerable populations. I would prefer to say underserved populations. Right? Vulnerability suggests an inherent weakness in the population. Underserved suggests that populations have been failed. The south side of Chicago is not vulnerable, it's underserved. And so the question of what kinds of social infrastructure are required to ensure access to underserved populations, I think, is an essential one.
And Harriet Washington, as we wrap up, what can instill public trust at this point? And the issue of patents. The U.S., for example, and this is true around the world, has put billions into these vaccines. Who gets the patent? And that means who gets the profit? Shouldn't this be made available free to all?
The patent system is what separates the people of the developing world from the medications that they have proved to be safe and efficacious. We rely upon them to help us test our medications. A good proportion of research is now done in the developing world by U.S. researchers and U.S. companies. And yet, when the drugs are developed, people there do not have access to them because they're priced beyond their ability to pay. Companies can do that because of U.S. patent law. And I argued in my book, Deadly Monopolies, that U.S. patent law needs to be changed. It should not govern the distribution of medication. It's what's responsible for the high prices and the lack of availability to people who need it most. I do also want to say something I think is really important in terms of domestic issues, and that is that we are framing this conversation erroneously. We're talking about the need to recruit more and more people of color. The figures given by Dr. Fauci, 27% African Americans represent 13.3% of people in the country. So Fauci is suggesting that twice our representation should be in these vaccine trials. Why? Unfortunately, this is a subtle form of blaming the victim. By hanging the success of vaccine design on African Americans and Hispanic people, that we're imparting responsibility that is not fair. Because in reality, Their fear, their reticence to engage in vaccine design is not the problem. The problem is the untrustworthiness of the U.S. healthcare system. We have to address both things. We can't just talk about African-American and Hispanic behavior and not talk about a healthcare system that is creating a situation where logical people have a rational fear.
We have to leave it there. I want to thank you, Harriet Washington, for joining us, author of Medical Apartheid, and Kaushik Sundararajan, professor of anthropology at University of Chicago. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh. Stay safe.